All right, let's take a look at the viewport toolbar. Every single viewport in UDK has its very own toolbar, but the options between them all are completely identical. So for the purposes of this video, I will only be looking at the viewport toolbar for the perspective view. Now, just to make things a little more visually stimulating, I'm going to do a couple of things. One, I'm going to open up a level. So let's go to File, Open, and I'm going to pick on VCTF Necropolis and click Open. And we get this massive level, which is a vehicle capture the flag map from Unreal Tournament 3. Now, I know we're talking about the viewport toolbar, and I'd like to do a left-to-right progression, but I'm going to break convention just a little bit. The very last button on the right of each toolbar is labeled Maximize Viewport. If you hold your mouse over it, you get a little tooltip for it. If you click on that, the perspective view will go just about full screen. It fills up the entire interface. So let's go ahead and do that. It'll make certain things that we show a little more obvious. Now moving over to the left-hand side, we have the Viewport Options menu. If you click on this, there are a lot of different options. However, most of these are available as buttons of their own inside the toolbar. And wherever that's the case, we're not going to talk about them right now. We're actually going to wait until we get to the Viewport Toolbar button for that function. So at the very top, we have Show. This is a submenu that gives you a list of different types of actors that you can show or hide at will. Now, if you're completely new to UDK and you don't have the first clue what half of these are and you don't know when you'll be using this, don't worry. The more you get used to using UDK, the more levels you create, you'll start to understand what each one of these things are, and you'll start to realize that there are specific circumstances under which you may want to hide any number of these objects. As a case in point, if you look over on the right-hand side of the view, surrounding nearly every single surface in our level right now is kind of a pink wireframe. These are blocking volumes. These keep the player from snagging on a stray polygon or bumping into something they shouldn't. They basically offer an invisible collision surface during gameplay. If we don't like seeing those, if we find those distracting, we can come down inside the show list to volumes. Also notice that volumes is attached to the hotkey O. But we can uncheck volumes, and now all of those pink boxes disappear. If I want to, I can hit the O key here inside the view and bring those back. Now, again, if you don't really know what most of these objects are as you look through that list, again, I don't want you to worry about that now, but if you're ever working here inside a viewport and there's a certain type of object that you're looking for and you feel should be visible and you just don't see it, this should be one of the first places your eyes go. You should jump right over to the viewport options and take a look in your show list. For example, if you're just starting a new level and you don't see the grid for some reason, remember to check and see if your grid is visible. Just as a side note about that, also make sure you're not in game mode, but that's something that we'll save for just a few more lessons. Now, that's just a quick look at the show list. Again, a lot of different things here that you could potentially show or hide. Now, down from here, we have real time. We have several different view modes, and we have game view. These are all analogous to various buttons along the toolbar, so we're not going to discuss those here in this video. The next option we have that is not its own button is the Unreal Matinee Preview. This allows you to determine whether or not matinee movies will play back in this viewport. This is on by default in the perspective view, but to really show it in action, let's open up a matinee animation. Now, inside of VCTF Necropolis, there are several different matinees that already exist. To open one of them up, you can click the Open Matinee button. It looks like a little tiny clapboard up in the main toolbar of the interface. If you click this, you'll get a big list of all of the different matinee sequences. Now, without getting too far off track, a matinee sequence is just some form of animation that was created with Unreal Matinee. What I want to do is select the very first one. It's labeled sequence.seekact_interp_6. If we click on that, we get the matinee window. You'll notice some sound started playing in the background. If I click the play button here inside Unreal Matinee, and I'm not going to go into anything else in Matinee, but the play button's kind of obvious. If I click this, then here in the background, Matinee is actually showing us playback here inside the view. If we go back to the Viewport Options menu while this is playing and switch off Unreal Matinee Preview, that camera is going to fly on without us, which you just saw it do. But if I go back and switch Unreal Matinee Preview back on, we jump to the location of that camera. So it's just a way for you to preview any cinematics or any type of animation that you may have created with Matinee here inside the viewport. I'm going to go ahead and click Stop and close Unreal Matinee, And that will just drop the camera back off here inside this building. So I'm just going to fly back out here and get us outdoors again. Now moving down, the next thing we have is unlit movement. If while you are editing your level, you notice that moving around the camera makes things get a little slow just because of all the added motion, maybe you've got a really complex scene, you can switch on unlit movement and watch this really closely. As I move the camera, all lighting information switches off. This can lead to much smoother motion if you're just trying to get around your view. And there you go. As soon as we stop moving the camera, the lights turn back on. So pretty obvious what that one's doing. Now, next we have view culling and occlusion. I'm going to hold on to that for just a moment. We're going to deal with that a little bit separately. And I'm going to jump right over to hidden groups. This submenu allows you to show and hide groups that you have created in your level. Now, I don't want to get too far off track, but we can create our own groups. There's actually a separate browser window specifically for working with groups. I will show it to you real quick. If we go to the main menu bar, we go down to browser windows and choose the group editor. This window, without going too far into its functionality, allows us to create and edit groups of objects in our scene. For example, you see there's a lights group, and this contains all of the lights in the level. So you could sit here and selectively grab any one of these groups, grab the objects within them, and see what objects are placed, you know, in any part of the level. Now, inside our viewport options menu, we can come down to hidden groups, and we can show or hide any one of these groups after they're created. That's really all there is to it. Very, very straightforward. But you have to have created a group on your own using the group editor for that to really be functional. Now, down from here, we have the viewport type. Now, currently, this is obviously a perspective view, but we can switch it over to a top view if we'd like. So now it's an orthographic top view. Notice it's still in lit mode. So everything still shows all sorts of nice lighting. I could go back down to the viewport type, and I could set that to a front view, which is going to be really interesting to look at. There we go. Let's zoom out, and now we can see that mountain. Or we could set it to a side view as well. Now, I'm going to go back down here and set this back to perspective and give us that three-dimensional view once again. So that's a quick look at all those options. Now, there was one left that I wanted to save, and that was view culling and occlusion. Now, to show this off, let me get back over here to where I was. So we'll get over a little bit closer to the main part of the level. I'm just dragging with the left mouse button to get us a little closer to the main part of the action. I'm going to put us right down in the middle of this, staring at this bridge. Kind of moved far away when I jumped over to those orthographic views. Now, let's demaximize the viewport. So remember that maximize viewport button we clicked? I'm going to click that again to make that go away. Now, using some of the things we've already learned, I'm going to pick on this viewport here just to the right of our perspective viewport, and I'm going to set this to another perspective viewport. You can have as many perspective viewports as you like. Now let's take this one. We'll also set it to a lit mode. There's a lit button specifically for that. Or here inside the view, we can choose lit. Now what I'm going to do is navigate this camera so that both of these objects are looking at the same thing. Also, I'm going to put both of these cameras in game mode, okay? So I'm going to tap the G key in each one. So make sure you put focus in one view and tap G. Now let's put focus in the other and tap G as well. So both of these views are in game mode. They're both showing exactly what the player would see during gameplay. Now, all of that is just a setup to make sure that the view culling and occlusion option makes a little bit more sense, because if you're totally new to UDK, this one might be a little bit confusing. What this option does is it turns whichever viewport you activate it for into the occlusion parent. Inside of Unreal, when you're actually playing the game, any object that is occluded, meaning it's hidden completely behind another object, or maybe it's just outside your field of view, that object will stop rendering. It'll literally turn invisible, and that keeps things nice and fast for the system. It doesn't render anything that the player isn't looking at. If you want to preview this effect, you can use the option View Culling and Occlusion. I'm going to take this horizontal splitter bar, and we'll slide that up a little bit, so we really just have these two primary views. And then here on the left perspective view, I'm going to come down and switch on View Culling and Occlusion. Now take a look. On the right-hand side, we suddenly see the words Occlusion Child. So the view on the left is our occlusion parent. The view on the right is our occlusion child. I'm going to navigate around here inside our occlusion child view for a moment and get us really close to where this camera is. We can see the camera because it shows us all the points coming into the view over here, this kind of purple wireframe that we're looking at. And let's just get kind of right over that camera's shoulder at sort of a nice distance. Now watch, as I rotate the left-hand camera, I'm also going to switch the right-hand camera to real-time to make this really apparent. So there's a real-time button here, a little joystick. Now watch, as I switch this on, you see what's happening over in the right-hand view? Everything that falls out of range of the left-hand camera is disappearing. It's because those objects are occluded, and anything that is occluded from our occlusion parent is no longer visible. So this is just a way for you to preview how occlusion is working in your level. And again, it takes a little bit of setup to really understand what's going on. So what we did is we set up a second perspective view in lit mode, and we set it to real time so that in our occlusion child, we could see real time visibility changes for all of the objects in our scene as they become occluded. Now that is a quick look at many of the functions here inside our viewport options menu. Again, we didn't really hit on anything that has its own button. We'll talk about that as we move forward. But for now, we'll go ahead and end this video, and then we'll move forward and take a look at some of the other options here inside the viewport toolbar. Before we leave, though, let's set everything back the way it was. I'm going to come over to viewport options, switch off view culling and occlusion. Let's drag our splitter bar back down to about halfway, and then we'll grab this viewport and we'll set its viewport type back over to a front view. And then I'll go back under the menu one more time and we'll set it to brush wireframe view. So that will wrap up this video and we'll just move forward from here.